hardly need reminding, but yes, it is election time. The climax of weeks, well, let's face it, months of campaigning. And voters are getting ready to decide who should govern the country. What better time to take a look back at how the BBC has been covering election nights over the decades? I'm Peter Snow, and I've enjoyed being part of that coverage for years. But now that I've laid down the swingometer, I get just as much pleasure sitting on the sofa at home and watching it all, and looking back at it with you. So welcome to 60 years of swing.
Here in the Limegrove studio, we are waiting for the first results. From the first results, we can probably tell, to quite an extent, what is likely to happen in this general election.
Good evening. Welcome to Election Studio One at the Television Centre in London.
But elections wouldn't be elections without a bit of the razzmatazz and even a bit of a gamble.
Good evening. Well, it looks like being one of the most exciting election nights ever, with the possibility of a very close result and the prospect of Britain having its first woman Prime Minister at the end of the night.
Well, we'll be looking back to the days when results were hand-painted onto cards and the swingometer just stayed on the wall. I'll be revisiting some of my favourite graphics, and we'll be hearing about some memorable moments in our election history. I can remember it all so well.
Where there is discord, may we bring harmony.
Where there is discord, may we bring harmony.
And I don't think anyone had done that before. Well, Francis of Assisi. Obviously, but that was years ago. I think that was Peter Snow's first one.
John Jeremy Thorpe,
Liberal,
23,338, 23,338.
Twig, Stephen, Labour Party, 20,507.
Well. A new dawn has broken, has it not?
Pupils from local schools running. And they've practiced all this. They've actually weighed the paper to make sure they get paper that can be counted fast. Sunderland comes in and the suffragist starts saying, ah, if it goes like this, this is what will happen, you know. And I think that's the excitement of it. And that's why doing it is a kind of adventure always. It's not one of those programmes where you sit and say, now we've got this, now we've got that, now we've got the other. You're on a voyage of discovery during the programme.
Our story begins in the 1950s with an inspirational trailblazer, the BBC's Grace Wyndham Goldie. The general election of 1951, Churchill's victory, was covered as little more than a news story. For the next election, 1955, Goldie devised a special television programme which would report on the results as they came in. It was presented by Richard Dimbleby.
Thirty minutes ago, the polling stations closed and voting in the general election ended. In the course of the next 6 or 7 hours, and in the 13 or 14 hours after that, we're going to try to give you not only the story of the development of everything that's happened since voting finished, and the course of the election and its results, but individual results just as fast as they come in to us.
What mattered, of course, was the results, and the BBC introduced the nation to a new science with an ancient name, psephology, the study of the vote. Teams of psephologists, armed with their slide rules like this and a good working knowledge of percentages, took their predictions to the airwaves.
When we've had 5 or 6 results, I think we really shall be fairly confident about the actual number of seats that are likely to be in the majority.
Is that what's called being a psephologist? I've heard that word used about you, and I gather it's rather a controversial word.
It's a somewhat indiscreet word which was coined by my mentor in the study of elections, Mr. R.B. McCallum, who said that we must have a word to describe the study of elections, and he invented this word, psephology. When the Greeks, the ancient Greeks, voted in Athens, they dropped a pebble in the urn, and they called it a psephos. And so there is this word, psephology, P-S-E-P-H-O-L-O-G-Y.
William Whitehead Hicksbeach has been duly elected Member of Parliament for the Cheltenham constituency.
Well, news has got outside.
Until 1968,
64, I think it was still 64, they were always hand-painted. And the ink took a little time to dry. So we had about 45 seconds from the actual statistics coming in from the computer online. I had a larger team of Nuffield College students working with side rules, and they could produce the results and write the percentages down within 30 seconds or so. And so I could always speak with complete authority about that's a 2% swing. That's the biggest swing we've had yet tonight.
And a 0.9% swing to Labour. In other words, something that would leave the Conservatives in comfortably nationally if it were repeated throughout the country.
If I describe it as an archaeological dig, they're the people with the brushes sort of brushing away and looking and examining little bits, putting it all together.
David Dimbleby. And we also heard there from David Butler, still on top of the story, age 90. Alongside the slide rule, the BBC election teams deployed the latest technology, setting the standard for all future coverage.
Mrs. Gelderly, how long are you going to be on the air?
Well, we are starting up at 9:15 on polling day. We're going on till 4 in the morning. As you know, results will be coming in from up till about 4 o'clock in the morning, and as we feel that this is a service to the public, we shouldn't stop just when we fancy it, but we should go on giving them results up while they're still coming out. And David Butler will be assisted by a team of statisticians from Nuffield, but he'll also be assisted on this occasion by an electronic computer.
Well, we're having one of the largest electronic computers specially assembled in the studio, and really we can do anything we could possibly want in the way of providing statistical analysis, and a constant stream of it will be available for David Butler and his own team of experts to digest and pass on to the viewers.
Something else happens to the results as well. They're passed down here into an electronic computer which we have nicknamed Ella. That's the girl, the big one down standing down the end of the room. She's very complicated. The results go into Ella. They're sent in by the girls who work here. And in the end, they come out again up the other end of the room up here in the form of statistics, which nobody can understand except David Butler and his statisticians there.
I hope I can understand them. It's my job, aided by Ella and my friends here with their slide rules, to try and explain as clearly as I can what is happening in each case.
And here in the studio, we've got bank after bank after bank of computers, all waiting to receive something like 35 million votes, 651 constituencies.
It's one of the few similarities between political TV coverage and the James Bond movies. They always want to showcase the cutting-edge technology of the moment. And just as in Diamonds Are Forever, James Bond drives into Dover and the camera pans up and zooms in to a sign that says, to the hovercraft. In exactly the same way, in 1966, the BBC's election coverage opens with a shot of a computer. It's just a keyboard sitting there and they hold on it. And the whole title sequence is going, we have a computer.
Well, as those millions of votes come pouring in, they go into this great monster computer. It's a Honeywell H200 series, which incidentally was made in Scotland for the electors up there. The card reader here down the bottom is where the information is actually fed into the machine. Behind us, the magnetic tapes on which is stored all the information about the 1964 election. 2.5 seconds later, the result comes out. And out with that result comes a great deal of data about the results. The information is vital to another part of our high-speed operation.
It became a feature of election programmes that the battle in the studio between the human experts and the computer has been even more intense than the battle in the constituencies.
In the older ones, it's lovely seeing the attitude towards a computer. And so there'll often be two or three people in the studio who believe in the computer and an extremely flustered guy, and he's often defending the computer.
Let's go to our computer at the end. I'm not calling you a computer, Graham Powell.
No.
I merely mean that you're our human interpreter of the computer.
Well, I'll do my best to humanly interpret what the computer's saying,
It's saying at the moment that the most likely result is an overall majority for the Conservatives, with a lead probably over Labour of about 80 seats. This seems to be the most likely result at the moment, but of course there's a lot of uncertainty still about that.
Well, let's clear up with the man who talks to the computer. Come on, talk to us, Graham.
Well, indeed, as David's just said, the prediction has now put the Conservatives ahead by 2 seats. We might well be in a situation where neither of the major parties has an overall 318. We're not certain that that's happening, but that seems to be the outcome on which the computer is converging at this point.
Obviously, those people now run the world, the people who were in the back looking flustered and trying to make computers work.
Can I ask you, in view of the narrowness of the way things are going, to you as a housewife, does it matter who gets in tomorrow?
I should say, I think it matters a lot. I think if the Tories get back, the prices will shoot up.
This is Kenneth Allsop in the city, where certain attempts are being made to pull chestnuts out of the fire. How has the news this morning affected your trade?
Well, a crowd has affected my trade this morning. Under the sheer television, a crowd is affecting it because I'm not doing no trade.
I feel that it's going to be 1945 all over again, if not even better. We'll have Mac out and Hugh Gateskill in.
Well, what do you think this present Labour government ought to do for boys and girls of around your age, your secondary modern school children? What do you think they ought to do?
Should improve the standard of education for start.
Yes.
Now, Leeds is at present on its way to work, and not many people have time to stop even to give a view. Leeds being a working city, it's extremely difficult to grab anyone to give an opinion.
Now, going into the middle of it, and hope that I'll come out alive, but we'll see what happens. In the meantime, back to Richard Dimbleby in the studio.
By 1959, that was the year when the Tories won again, this time led by Harold Macmillan, a BBC tradition had been established. A marathon results programme broadcasting into the night and sometimes way beyond that. The format hasn't changed much over the years, and the accent has always been on the side of the spectacular.
I think the key to an election night is very simple, actually. I mean, we'll take a Dimbleby as standard, right? It needs an attached Dimbleby. You can't have anything with gravitas without a Dimbleby. I want people milling around in the background. That is very important as well. No one's quite sure what they're doing. Sometimes you get a bit bored with Dimbleby. You want to look over his shoulder, see what the people are doing behind him. That's also key.
It's a test match special for politics. You have the colour man, normally a Dimbleby of some sort. Sitting next to him, you have the expert summariser, and on the other side, the statistics man, who can explain what's going on for those of us who can't quite keep up.
This studio here is one of the very biggest in the country, and for the next 24 hours it's going to be the centre of a news and analysis operation.
Good evening, and what an extraordinary campaign it's been. It began as a two-horse race, it ended with 3 starters at the line.
What's amazing is how little it has actually changed. And you did have the same sort of, and they're like James Bond villains' lairs, the sets. And this was in the 60s when everyone was watching on tiny little black and white televisions. They still have these huge sets, you know, with a Dimbleby sitting in the middle, you know, saying, okay, Mr. Bond, with this device I can wipe out your majority. Nothing's changed.
And cutting a swathe through the counting in the chat was the Swingometer. Thank you very much. It's swung back and forth through most election nights since the 50s. I've got one here, a very simple one, just to explain to you how it works. Its great virtue is that one single measure, swing, describes the shift in the vote from one election to another. So, for example, if the net effect of the change is that 5 people in every 100 who voted Conservative last time vote Labour this time, then there is a 5% swing to Labour. An almost magic way of bringing alive with just one word, swing, a key measure of what's happening in an election. Thank you very much. Well, over the years, the BBC Swingometer took on rather majestic proportions. It's been the heart and soul of the show. So let's take a closer look at the Swingometer in action.
The reason why one can make a pretty good guess early on in the proceedings about the final outcome is because we in Britain are, perhaps thank God, so unified a country, that what happens in one part of the country seems to happen in another. Past election results have shown an extraordinarily even turnover in votes in one constituency and another right throughout the country.
The Swingometer is an odd thing. It's been attributed to me, actually, somebody doing a regional thing from the southwest in the 1955 election produced a little version of the Swingometer.
If we look at the swing, we find that the swing in Southampton, for the two divisions put together, it doesn't make sense to take them separately because of redistribution, the swing is approximately 1.5%.
I thought it was very good, and so I persuaded Grace that in the 59 election we should make a biggish thing of this. And so we had a swingometer which was about 7 foot by 5, and with the swing one way and the other, and showing how you transfer a certain movement in votes into a much bigger movement in seats. And it worked and was thought nice and was made a major part of the 64 election. And when we reallocated jobs, Bob took on this job of talking to the swingometer.
Here's another way of looking at that all-important swing that David Butler's been talking about. At the last election, the Conservatives led Labour by 107 seats.
My favourite character was always Bob McKenzie.
With the swingometer. Now, the thing about the swingometer is it goes to the left and then it goes to the right, and then it can doesn't really go down the middle, but he's got to move it either that way or that way. And I love Bob McKenzie, because in the 70s you very rarely got a very interesting voice on television that wasn't, you know, PR British. And suddenly, on election night, you got this rather strange man with strange sideburns sort of swinging away and being rather excitable. And I loved him to bits.
We start from October 74 result, Labour 3-seat overall majority. Mrs. Thatcher has to get not just a 1%, 2%, 3%, 4%, 4.5%.
It wasn't so much what the swingometer did, is the fact that it was quite funny. Because, you've got the
word swing, you've got the word swingers. Somewhere inside there is the possibility they will say that. And the swingometer itself was a sort of flaccid phallic symbol that sort of waggled in the middle. So I always enjoyed that.
They're even having to extend his swingometer. Let's see him doing it. There he is.
Well,
he's
rather
having
like
to paint
painting
the
Sistine Chapel here. We bring the swingometer up to date to make room for the kind of swings. There have been several, around 9% to the Conservatives, one of them being Enoch Powell's swing. But the other national swing is settling in this vicinity, 4.7% swing. And this is rather lower than we'd been getting earlier on, when it was about around 5 to 6%.
Well, I think the most obvious thing to say about the Scottish results is there's a 14.5% swing from the Conservatives to the Nationalists. We had prepared here a little swingometer which shows you the seats which the Nationalists might expect to gain from the Conservatives. And the first news tonight is that we are already right off this swingometer.
Importantly, the swingometer, of course. Now, it disappeared for a while. It disappeared, and then it came back, you know, like everyone, like take that. It's the sort of take that of electoral measurement. And it vanished, and people cried, and there were people, you know, hurting themselves and writing sad letters and joining fans. Oh, the swingometer, we love you, where are you? And then it reformed, didn't it? It came back.
Well, let me introduce our new BBC swingometer for the 90s. First of all, the two arrows. There's the swing to Labour, to the left, and the swing, the blue arrow showing the swing to the Conservatives, to the right. Now, can I have the pendulum, please? Here it comes. Thank you very much, Harry. That's it. There's our new pendulum.
It's a thing that swings, right? It's just that. It goes left, it goes right. Slightly more complicated when the Lib Dems come into play. I realise it might be even more complicated this time, but it goes left and it's right. I can figure it out. There's two colours to be dealing with. But then he tries to explain percentages, and then my brain shuts down. But it doesn't matter, because it looks pretty.
I remember being asked to take part in it, and I think it was 1992, I think, and they sent us up to Manchester, and so we'd written a whole lot of bits and pieces, but we thought we'd do one with Peter Snow, with a swingometer, because that was such a staple of the coverage, so we thought we'd do a sort of swingometer spoof, but not quite the one they were expecting.
Blue arrow
It's all just a bit of fun. Let's go back now, straight, live. Don't forget, watch that swingometer. If it goes that way, it's Kinnock. That way, it's Major. If it goes that way, it's Paddy Ashdown. Now, back to Mission Control and David.
And here in the studio, Peter Snow will be telling the story with his latest wizardry.
Yes, David, we'll have all sorts of colourful ways of illustrating this election. None, of course, more spectacular than our swingometer. But this time, for the first time in history, we're going to bring it down off its wall and lay it right down here on the studio in front of us. And it won't this time be a pendulum that moves among the MPs, scything them up and down. It'll be a laser beam, zapping them from blue to red and red to blue. Isn't that a sensational sight? We'll get back to those marvellous graphic displays later in the programme. But now let's consider another early indicator of how the results might go, the exit poll. Based on asking voters how they voted after the event, rather than asking them beforehand how they might vote. It's unveiled at 10 o'clock once voting has ended. And I can tell you it's the most nervous moment of the night. You're never quite sure how accurate that exit poll is going to be. It's true that in recent years it has been pretty reliable. But I can remember vividly one year when things didn't quite go to plan.
The exit poll got it wrong. John Major's election, wildly wrong.
In 1992, the exit poll pretty much predicted a hung parliament, when in fact it was a decisive victory for the Tories.
Good evening and welcome to the BBC's election night coverage. In a few moments' time, the polls will close all over the country, and at 10 o'clock, the start of what could be one of the most dramatic and exciting election nights since the war.
Now, the truth is, of course, this was an election at which the opinion polls were suggesting that probably it was going to be a hung parliament, but probably the Labour Party being the largest party.
I remember they were working away at it, because it is obviously a very complicated science. I don't blame the sophologists for it.
We had to move after 9:15 from the room in which we've been doing the exit poll all day, you know, under close lock and key, so to make sure that nobody could, in no way did it leak, to moving into the studio. And shall we say, the move into the studio did not go entirely smoothly so far as getting the computer communications going. And we only literally managed to get the final wave of the data in the system and transferred for transmission literally a matter of a minute or two before we went on air. I well remember Peter Snow saying, where is it?
And now our exit poll. Based on talking to lots of people as they came out of the polls today in some of the key marginal constituencies, just like any other poll, it has its range of error one way and the other, but it's just a first indication of the story we may be getting as the night goes on.
And then, of course, what we discover, because at this point we were on automatic pilot, we were just analysing the data in the way we had been doing all day, it flipped. And all of a sudden, it was still a hung parliament, but we then had the Conservatives as the largest party, just. So, actually, it wasn't quite as wrong as perhaps some people remember.
I remember walking onto the set, walking up to announce it, and not knowing, when I got to the top of the steps, whether the picture that came up would be Neil Kinnock or John Major. 10 o'clock, and our view is it's going to be a hung parliament. This election is too close to call. And all hell was let loose over there. We're saying it could be from the Conservatives short by 10 of an overall majority to Labour, the largest party, and short by 13 of an overall.
During the night, it became clear that all the wise pollsters had egg on their face, because it was meant to be the election where Neil Kinnock was going to win. He'd been to the Sheffield rally, he'd said, "Well, yeah!" and he'd revved up his troops.
"We're all right!"
But then, of course, Major came along and he won. It was the spiral of silence, the election when, in the privacy of the polling booth, a lot more people actually voted Tory than had the guts to tell pollsters that they were going to do so.
David Anthony Andrew Amos, Conservative, 159.
By my memory and reckoning, this is the worst performance by the opinion polls since polling began.
Anyway, after this one, it was decided that something had to be done, and all the broadcasters got together and worked on the exit poll. And I think as a result of that, well, first of all, if we sink, we all sink together, which is good. But the real thing is that I think it got more sophisticated the way it's done. There is Big Ben in the tower. Big Ben, of course, referring to the bell
not the tower itself, and the BBC's exit poll is there, projected on there, and as the results come in, we will continue to put them up there at the very heart of Parliament.
Not too bad a record. I wonder how right they'll get it this time, particularly as we seem to be heading for a very tight finish. Anyway, the programme's underway. We've had the exit poll and we've heard from the experts in the studio. The polling stations close at 10 o'clock and in leisure centres and town halls across the nation, the great count begins. It's time to check in with our team of reporters. Some of them will be on air fairly swiftly. There's always a race to be the first constituency to declare. But for others, it'll turn out to be a very long night indeed.
As you can see, the great count has already started. And all over the country, the ballot boxes are being rushed to the counting halls.
The first ballot box was brought in at 9:10. The first job was to count the total of the votes cast, and now they're being sorted according to the voting. And there's a sound here, a sound of the rustling paper like the falling of steady rain.
The queues outside, it's quite extraordinary, these scenes. Look at this in Leeds, queues of people who were unable to vote, waiting to go and vote. It's a disgrace, this, isn't it? It's really a disgrace.
It is really shocking to see.
Particularly since they've had so many more people doing postal voting, you'd think there'd be plenty of room. And so look at that.
It's both at one and the same time, isn't it? Very exciting to see the desire to vote, but the thought that in this country, in a democracy, people could want to vote and not be able to, will cause fury.
It's third world politics.
It's been a warm and balmy day here in Guildford, and the turnout is being predicted as very high indeed, about 80%. On the floor, there is frenetic activity. 115 counters and 20 supervisors counting the votes as they pour in from the 63 polling stations in the Guildford constituency.
As a secondary check, they tie up the ballot papers into 100 ballot paper bundles and they weigh them on some very old-fashioned weighing scales. Well, they may be old-fashioned, but I'm told that they're pretty accurate. We're hoping that that secret device will mean that we can be the first to declare a result at around about 10 minutes past 11.
Cheltenham has always paid its counters slightly below the odds on the grounds that the more counters they get, the quicker they do it. So they have 144, including supervisors, and they're all bank employees with very nimble fingers.
I can see headlights as the cavalcade of cars sweeps into the City Hall in Cardiff, and we think that the Prime Minister is down there.
The Prime Minister arriving here at Cardiff South East. He's just come from his hotel. He was meant to have come here an hour and a half ago, but he was held up, allegedly, because there was a puncture in his police car. He has said nothing to anyone. You can see he's going in and saying nothing now. I have to report, though, that the mood here in the Labour camp is of deep dejection. His agent just said to me, it's a great tragedy for Mr Callaghan, because he can't come back.
I love general elections so much, because I think they're like the Eurovision Song Contest for people who got bullied at school. I absolutely love them. It's the one night of the year where power returns from the gilded palaces of Westminster to fusty town halls with grumpy-looking women in fleeces.
Well, now, I've just heard that there's a goodish crowd collecting outside, so let's go out there to look at them with Sam Pollock outside the town hall at Leeds.
Well, now, here outside Leeds Town Hall at the moment, there is quite a considerable crowd, despite the fact that we're going to have to wait, I think, about 2 hours before we know the earliest local result. Mind you, as well, of course, they will hear the other early results from the loudspeaker system here, and some of them, I notice, even have got their own portable radios with them.
Well, I don't think Mr. Jeremy Thorpe himself has actually arrived here in the Queen's Hall Barnstaple. In fact, when I came through to you earlier on, I said that we were expecting the result at about 1 o'clock. I'm not at all sure about that. It may well be a little bit later, because the last ballot box at 11:35 was still on the platform there.
This is the Mayor's Parlour, where we were before, and the Prime Minister is meant to come here. He was meant to have a celebratory drink with the Mayor, with the Lord Mayor, but of course, the Prime Minister doesn't drink. The Lord Mayor himself was very dejected. They're hoping that he's coming up the corridor now.
Behind me, there is a definite air of excitement. People are expecting that the vote for possibly the next Prime Minister is about to be counted any moment, and there could be a turnout of 82%.
And Kate Adie.
Well, here in Huntingdonshire, the Conservatives are at least happily confident of re-electing John Major.
I always like seeing the efforts that local borough councils go to
to make the most of their 30 seconds on national television.
Torbay, the country's most marginal seat and the Tories' top target. It's vital for them to win it back from the Lib Dems. But will Labour supporters vote tactically to keep them out?
And what will happen to the man who went from being Mr Blair's closest cabinet colleague to the humble MP for Hartlepool? We're here tonight to see whether the voters want Peter Mandelson back in Parliament.
I always love it when they've put up banners and slogans and you're in like a leisure centre somewhere and there'll be a big thing saying South Worcestershire, where it's all going on.
Good evening to you. There are 71 constituencies in Scotland, but we won't be able to show you the result of four of them, indeed, even when this programme is over tomorrow evening. Because, as you can see by looking at the map, it's very difficult to bring the ballot boxes from, let's say, Mull, all the way round the Mull of Kintyre to Dunoon, where they're counted, or even overland to Oban.
I do love those moments where they cut away to the count, because obviously somebody says, like, we've got news, they're going to declare the result in Nuneaton. And they go, I think we've got something from Nuneaton. And it goes, and people are just wandering around aimlessly, and it's clear they won't have the result for another 5 hours. Somebody's got to fill, say, well, it's very, very exciting around me, but I think we're not quite ready yet. Back to you, David.
This is an area which has a lot of statues of famous Welsh people, including Owen Glendower, David Lloyd George, Boadicea, who is looking down on us. Everyone's still waiting for the Prime Minister to come. They're waiting in the count for him as well. I understand that it's been a higher turnout here, although we don't have any indication of what the result will be. The result is much higher. The turnout here is 73.6%, which is compared to 70.7%.
You need to return to endless correspondence on the end of endless cameras telling you that they don't know any more than they did 45 minutes ago, and enjoy as they try and cobble together 3 minutes of something to say, because you know the producer's screaming in their ear, you have to keep the end of this programme up because the sat truck has gone missing and there's no mobile phone coverage and they can't get any parking. Keep talking! You can see it in their eyes, the fear in their eyes. They know they have to keep on talking. And they know their mum's watching. They know their whole career depends on it. And they've just got nothing to say because nothing has happened.
We're still hoping that the Prime Minister is coming round this corridor, which is where he's due to come. Although this is a city hall with many corridors, most of them have been locked off, partly by the security people here. It's conceivable that the Prime Minister may have chosen to come make a rather undignified entrance through a back passage, which would take him through the staff canteen and up the back passage, which would... We've learnt that he's actually stopped just outside the Assembly Hall, where he could go into the count, he could go straight into the count, but we understand that he's still waiting there to... And he may come round this corner, which is where he's still due to be coming at any moment.
Well, Michael, we can actually see the Prime Minister coming in now.
So he's changed all his plans. Instead of coming, as he was going to, straight to his own committee room A, which was where he was going to watch the results in triumph, you can see there he's talking to the returning officer, the acting returning officer. Prime Minister thought that the best way was to come straight into the count in order to avoid everyone who was waiting for him.
It's all the luck of the draw. The number of times I've stood by the wrong door. That long wait for results hasn't changed over the decades, but Britain itself has been transformed, as have social attitudes. Just take a look into the election studio of 1964, the year when Harold Wilson led Labour to number 10. Comments like this sound frankly bizarre now.
I've had a little message from the outside world to say that just as a change from politics and members of Parliament, who generally, with some exceptions, are not awfully pretty, that viewers would like to have a quick look at some of the girls who are working around us in the studio and doing such an invaluable job. Who can we give you for a start? There's Miriam Cork sitting down the end there, who didn't really know you were going to look at her, and she's being very discreet and modest.
It's the most extraordinary footage, and you would think that it was spoof.
We have in the background large numbers of the girls all wearing, I don't know what the colour is, it isn't salmon pink, it's sort of terracotta overalls, because we thought it would be less conspicuous if they were allowed to wear their own clothes, poor little things.
There were no female presenters, there were no female reporters, and the women who were on screen were sort of manning phones and being called pretty girls, and no one actually really knew what they were doing, although they were probably running the entire operation, I imagine.
There were charming girls on telephones, as if she didn't know she was being looked at. Down here in the foreground, you have some terribly hard-working girls who are killing themselves on your behalf.
And then there's a great bit where another viewer, again, somehow gets in touch and says there's a mouse. He'd seen a mouse running across the top of the board that's behind Dimbleby.
One more message I'd like to deal with. If what a woman viewer has just said were true, none of these girls would be in the studio. I've just been told that somebody outside declares that they've just seen a mouse run along the top of the State of the Parties board. I'm asked by the studio manager to tell you that this is not true, madam. Either you've been celebrating the election too well, or you had a little electronic mistake of some kind. There are no mice in here whatsoever.
And another new MP, Miss Janet Fuchs, who is a new Conservative lady MP. May I talk to Mrs. Fuchs first, who've been waiting rather a long time? Mrs. Fuchs, Miss Fuchs, I'm so sorry, and Miss Fuchs tells me that she's Miss Fuchs because no man has ever plucked up the courage to ask. Well, that's a challenge to any bachelors in the House of Commons, and perhaps one in particular, who knows? Miss Fuchs, may I ask how old you are?
If you must.
I must.
34.
Really, you don't look anything like that, if I may say so.
Ah, I think we ought to say that Miss Fuchs, incidentally, is the most gorgeous red hair. If you're seeing it in black and white, it is something you are missing.
I think if you go back and look at some of the early broadcasts from the 50s and 60s, some things are obviously very different. The graphics are more basic. There's a lot more smoking. I mean, everybody is smoking almost continuously in some of these early programmes.
A different world. But election night's also the cue for a party. And there have been some notable ones over the years, with the BBC occasionally joining in too.
But hanging from the windows with balloons and streamers, Conservative Party workers who've had 3 weeks and before that 6 months of preparation for this election.
Here now is a picture I dare not deny you. At 20 minutes past three in the morning, it comes from a discotheque, the one which we've had our outside broadcast cameras. We've denied you that pleasure for a long time. We shall deny it to you no longer.
Well, whilst you've been involved in the high drama in the entry studio, we've been down here in this discotheque talking to the young voters of Britain, the young people aged 18 and upwards who are voting for the first time. I'd like to ask you, first of all, what you voted, if I may. Laura, isn't it?
Yes, I voted Conservative.
Can you tell me why you did that?
Because I've seen what they've done to the middle-class businessmen, especially the family businesses. With the SAT tax, they've practically crippled business. A lot of people have been practically squeezed out of existence.
How old are you?
It's 4 in the morning, and hello to you in Trafalgar Square, and hello to you now in Oxford, and down there is Christopher Brasher.
In the dying embers of a party in the Oxford Union. Now, Giles Brandreth, you have been finishing your finals today.
Yes, only a few hours ago.
And you also took the journey all the way to London to vote
for Quentin Hogg. And who may well be Home Secretary. The only sinister part of the election, I think, in terms of the Tory victory, is the effect of the great support that obviously has been shown for Enoch Powell.
Come on inside with me, because
I remember in 2010 you had Andrew Neil, of course, encyclopedic knowledge of politics, and he's there broadcasting from the boat, and he's talking about the election to Ben Kingsley of Gandhi fame and Bruce Forsyth.
Nice to see you, to see you. I never had my...
And then Andrew asks him about the exit poll. What do you think of the exit poll, Bruce?
Sorry about that.
What do you think of the exit poll?
I thought it was, as you said, high. I think it's... anything could happen.
Let's get back to the graphics. As the results start to come in, we can start to see how all those electoral battles are being played out, the shape of the new parliament, and how the political map of the UK is changing. It's fascinating stuff and great fun developing the displays. The trick is to make them exciting and entertaining, but they must be clear and help explain the election.
Good evening, officer.
Yes, we're all ready for the excitement here, and I'll be pushing the frontiers of technology right to the extreme.
I think the joy, in fact, the whole point of watching BBC election coverage for decades was just to see what Peter Snow got up to, what graphics they'd given him, what props they'd given him, and how mad he would get. But there we go. It's all just a bit of fun. That was always his catchphrase. Just a bit of fun. Just a bit of fun. That's all it is. Let's watch that graphic. Down there, up there, through there.
How high up the staircase will he get? Because if he gets to the top and opens the door to number 10, then he'll have a post-war record for recovery. Now, as we fly around, watch the hits here clocking up in the little hit box. The first one we're going for is Plymouth Sutton, then Exeter, you can see just beyond it there. There goes Exeter. Here comes Portsmouth North, the most difficult of those targets to hit.
Let us see just how near David Cameron has got to that famous door. I'll bring on the paving stones now. We had 116. Each has the name of a seat. The Conservatives need to win on it. They need 116 extra seats for an overall majority.
Well, today nearly every data point has a matching graphic, and some of them are a bit strange. I do recall that I was rather surprised in 2010 to see Jeremy Vine laying the paving stones up to the door of number 10, with finally finishing Waverley saying this is what Cameron needs to get there. But I think there's something really exciting about them that really shows to the general public what is going on.
Way down the other end, we have our three candidates to become Prime Minister. We know jolly well which one's going to win.
If you'd bought a computer game in which Charles Kennedy and Michael Howard were available as zombies, that was what it looked like.
I love all graphics. I like Swingometers. I love the one where Peter Snow was having the cardboard cutouts of leaders running down the street. And I personally think that graphics just add to the colour and the fabric of election night. But I recognise I'm a political geek, and I really like data.
I think there is a tendency sometimes, particularly recently, for programmes to do fancy graphics just because they're able to do fancy graphics, and not to think, is this actually helping to explain what's going on to the viewer? I can think of a couple of really quite cringeworthy examples over the last 10 or so years, most notoriously the Jeremy Vine cowboy episode.
I'm gonna try and aim straight. 29%, that's what you got in the local elections when your leader was Charles the Party Kennedy. He may have fond memories of that one. 2005, now it was a general election. Let's just try this one here.
I think if you go back and look at programmes in the 50s or the 60s, they're very basic graphics, but they're often clearer and they help explain what's happening to the viewer in a way that actually some of today's modern fancy graphics sometimes don't do.
Three of the younger outstanding figures on the Conservative front bench are all so far returned.
I think sometimes with the graphics, the ambition can extend the abilities of the technology. My favourite example is from the 97 election, where there is an inexplicable brick wall and various Conservative ministers who will be crushed by the wall. But the wall very much is a kind of Windows 98 style screensaver wall. It bears no relation to the size of the cabinet ministers.
What's happened? Well, there it goes. The landslide, the Labour landslide, has buried no fewer than 9 of the 10 of our dicey dozen so far. Just going to have a quick look at who they are.
It can be great. And the graphic, for instance, of the House of Commons, where it fills up with people, is very nice. So I'm a great fan of them. And the fact that you can do something doesn't necessarily mean you should do something, because what matters is that the viewer gets it. And I remember once Peter had an extraordinary thing with little sort of figures on a triangle, and it was a three-way swingometer. I mean, I'm sure he understood it. I never did. I still grapple with it.
Well, it all made perfect sense to me. Let's now look at some of those results being announced, because that's the real drama of these programmes, the battles lost and won, the triumphs and disasters along the way. Here's a taste of them.
And the question now is, Mr. Brown going to lose the seat that he has held continuously for 25 years?
At the moment when a big name falls is always powerful, because people are very vulnerable at the end of a campaign.
Brown, George Alfred, the Labour candidate, 33,633. Stuart Smith, Dudley Jeffrey,
the Conservative candidate, 35,000.
A great big public job interview with the great British public, and the fact that they have to stand on stage really vulnerable. They've really tried, they really want this job, and they can't be blasé if they've lost it, because it's impossible to be blasé if you're wearing a rosette with your face on it. And there they are on stage finding out whether they've got their job, and I find that fascinating.
The one that I remember most was Jeremy Thorpe, and he had, you know, had a difficult time in the 70s, and I think it was the 79 election where the election result was announced and he'd lost.
Thorpe, John Jeremy Thorpe,
Liberal,
23,000.
And there was this big graphic came out, Jeremy Thorpe out, and you realise the brutality of election night.
And I hereby declare that Jonathan Said has been elected to serve as member for the said constituency.
And so Tony Benn, after 33 years, is out of the House of Commons.
At Finchley, Mrs. Thatcher is about to hear her result.
I think probably my all-time favourite election moment was in 1987, when they went to Finchley for the count, and it was... Everyone knew that Thatcher had won. This was her third election victory. And she was, at that point, I think, probably the most famous politician literally in the world. And she had to stand on stage in Finchley next to Lord Buckethead of the Gremloids Party. It was like everything that's great about Britain was encapsulated in that sort of the silliness and the eccentricity and the democracy and the seriousness and the fact that Thatcher was a world figure by this time.
There are some nights that really stick out for me. One was 1992 when Chris Patten, then the Tory chairman, lost his seat in Bath, which was a pivotal moment, although, of course, not a deciding factor in the outcome.
Christopher Francis Patten.
Conservative.
21,950.
Well, it's written on their faces.
Now, here is John Major tonight, and the scale of the landslide he has suffered.
Well, I think undoubtedly for anybody who's been involved in elections over the last 30, 40 years or so, the most dramatic election undoubtedly was the general election of 1997, when, of course, there was that enormous Labour landslide.
Portillo, Michael Denzel Xavier, 19,137. I declare that Stephen Twigg is duly elected Member of Parliament for the constituency.
And the producer with me was still saying, well, what more have we got to say? Where is the Conservative vote going down? And I said, Sean, sit down, shut up. We're not going to get anything on air for the next 2 hours. The story was the drama of people, cabinet ministers losing seats. The politicians on that night made the drama themselves. Us suffragists became somewhat superfluous.
Another defining moment, I think, was in 1997, not just with the big Blair landslide victory, which was bigger than anyone had expected, but it was the election victory, which felt like a by-election victory in Tatton.
Martin Bell.
Independent.
29,300.
I actually found the Tatton poll quite moving in some senses, not only because one of the candidates was called Miss Moneypenny the Transformer, but also because I thought Martin Bell was quite dignified in his victory. He didn't rub Neil Hamilton's nose in it. He just quoted G.K. Chesterton, of course.
Smile at us, pay us, pass us, but do not quite forget that we are the people of England and we have not spoken yet. You have spoken tonight magnificently, and I thank you from the bottom of my heart.
David Mellor with Jimmy Goldsmith down in Putney, where that was the speeches there were absolutely raucous.
To Sir James Goldsmith, who's got nothing to be smug about, and I would like to say that 1,500 votes is a derisory total. And we have shown tonight
that the referendum party is dead in the water. And Sir James, you can get off back to Mexico knowing your attempt to buy the British political system has failed.
They underestimated Hartlepool and they underestimated me because I am a fighter and not a quitter.
Reginald Thomas Keyes.
Independent.
4,252.
Reg Keyes, his son was killed in Iraq and stood here against the war.
I hereby declare that Caroline Lucas is duly elected Member of Parliament for the Brighton Pavilion constituency.
An enormous motorcade worthy of an American president circling the Prime Minister's car. Goodness knows who's on it. Perhaps all the press is on it as well. But this is the red carpet treatment.
Good grief, that's an extraordinary shot, isn't it?
But I think it's important, as this very graceful transfer of power takes place, to pause for a moment and realise there are about 20 or 25 countries in the world where this happens like this. And there are 150 countries in the world, and most of them are dictatorships, autocracies, military governors, all the rest. And I think we ought to pause and respect the fact that this is a great and exciting moment when, without any murmur, supreme power is laid down by one lot of chaps, picked up by another. And it's a rare thing.
It's a rather humbling thing for politicians, really, isn't it? Because they've got to acknowledge that ultimately they have no power at all. It's us, in, you know, where we put our cross that really matters. And as I said, it can be a very brutal night for certain people, but it's the night that belongs to us.
And of course, once the results are in, we get to hear live from the winners and the losers. And there have been some memorable encounters over the years.
Thank you, Mr. Day. I hope when you next interview me, you don't interrupt quite so often.
Mr. Brown, it is a little difficult interviewing somebody down the line, and I hope that you don't
take it... It's quite a little difficult being interviewed down the line.
I hope you don't take it personally.
Not a bit, Mr. Day. I like you immensely, but you must understand the rules by which we do this.
May I call you brother?
If you wish, I would be very flattered and delighted.
Goodbye, Mr. Brown.
Goodbye, Brother Day.
There was the wonderful moment where Robin Day got quite sort of heated with Enoch Powell and so,
Mr. Powell, will you be joining Mr. Heath's government were he to ask you?
That is a hypothetical question. In vain do you cast the net in front of the bird. That is Proverbs 1, verse 17. I looked it up.
Is it possible that in the flush of a Conservative victory, if there is one, that Mr. Heath should invite you to serve in a Conservative cabinet, you would accept?
Ah, yes. The old, old trap of a hypothetical question. In vain is the net spread in the sight of a bird. And you know, Robin, I'm too old a bird for that.
It wasn't meant as a trap. I was just doing my best, but I have to leave you now, Mr. Powell.
Yes, all right. Goodbye.
Thank you and sleep well.
Thank you.
As we've heard, the Liberals seem to have been going from strength to strength, but there's one Liberal who perhaps hasn't done quite as well as he hoped he'd do, and in fact the first loser we've interviewed, Mr. Ludovic Kennedy, who's failed in his second attempt to win Rochdale for the Liberals. He's in our Manchester studio with his wife, Myra Scherer, having their first meal for some hours, I imagine. Now, Mr. Kennedy, with the considerable increase in the Liberal vote in this country, aren't you disappointed that you failed to pull it off?
No, of course I am, yes, of course I am.
And just how disappointed are you?
Well, I'm very disappointed. What more do you want me to say?
Well, now, let's look rather more at your own campaign, your own victory. You're a bachelor and a television performer, and I'm told that you've conducted a very gay campaign. Which of these things would you say contributed most to your success?
Well, I don't know. I wouldn't say that either of them in themselves were a vote catcher. I think that people in Devon enjoy a little bit of gaiety, but I think they feel that they have to know you first before they'll stand much of it.
I think a huge change from 1955 is the deferential way in which politicians were treated then and are less so now. Partly it's humour, it's irreverence, but also partly it's because a lot of people in Britain have become very disillusioned with politics and certain politicians, definitely.
The wonderful thing about the sort of post-results interviews is you're seeing two sets of incredibly polished, incredibly professional people. So the people you get to anchor election broadcasts are, you know, Champions League quality presenters, and you have politicians mostly at the top of their game who are tired, fatigued, they've just gone through this big emotional moment, and you get a bit of handbags, you get a bit of argy-bargy. So there was the wonderful, you know, cantankerous question from Jeremy Paxman to George Galloway, are you proud of defeating one of the few ethnic minority women in Parliament? And George Galloway giving it all this.
Mr. Galloway, are you proud of having got rid of one of the very few black women in Parliament?
What a preposterous question. I know it's very late in the night, but wouldn't you be better by starting by congratulating me for one of the most sensational election results in modern history?
Are you proud of having got rid of one of the very few black women in Parliament?
No, Jeremy, move on to your next question.
It was one of the spikiest, most uncomfortable interviews to watch, I think probably to take part in as well.
Well, you are actually conducting one of the most, even by your standards, one of the most absurd interviews I have ever participated in. I have just won an election. Can you find it within yourself to recognise that fact? To recognise the fact that the people of Bethnal Green and Bow chose me this evening.
Oh, we recognise it.
Why are you insulting them?
I'm not insulting them.
Yes,
I'm not insulting you.
You are insulting them. They chose me just a few minutes ago. Can't you find it within yourself even to congratulate me on this victory?
Congratulations, Mr.
Thank
Galloway.
You very much indeed.
How do you propose to
Thank
use
you
your time
indeed.
In... Oh, I see. It's another occasion of you not wanting to talk to someone who doesn't agree with you.
Actually.
And what's so interesting about this exchange is that they are both big beasts, Galloway and Paxman. Galloway refuses to be intimidated by the standard Jeremy Paxman public school sneer. On the other hand, Paxo isn't going to be outpsyched by that bruising, brazen street fighter from Dundee, George Galloway. So they maul each other like two great dinosaurs. And in the end, as you know it's going to happen sooner or later, Galloway removes his microphone and leaves the set. So it's a victory for both of them, but also a defeat for them both. But it's an equal contest. Don't often see that on TV.
Good evening. Well, it looks like being one of the most exciting election nights ever. From now until 4 a.m, we'll be bringing you the fastest service of results and comment from the politicians. It's all over at last. Good evening and welcome to the BBC's election night coverage. For weeks, we've watched the politicians slugging it out together. Tonight, at last, we hear the voters' verdict as they tell us who's won. The people have spoken, and our job now is to find out what they've said as quickly as we can. We promise to be fast, we promise to be accurate, and we promise to have some fun. It's been the most exciting, unpredictable election for a generation. Over the next few hours, we'll discover what's happened. Welcome to election night here on the BBC.
I've got to go to David Dimbleby.
In the middle of eating a Mars bar. For someone somewhere, I'd love to do elections until I'm taken out in a coffin, to tell you the truth, because I do find them very enjoyable. And I'll tell you another thing, from a television point of view, they're absolutely fascinating because you're telling a story, but you have so many different things coming in, so much information, and turning it into a simple story is something I just relish doing.
It'll be an election night as intriguing as any in my lifetime. We can expect a very close result and a mass of speculation about what will happen as parties dash about trying to make their numbers add up to a government. Looking back at 60 years of swing, we've never had so many parties fighting to divide the spoils. It's going to be a fascinating contest. For this election results programme, I understand the BBC has no less than 4 swingometers to tell the story. I can't wait to see that. And I'm looking forward to those graphics too. Thank you for watching and good night.